Hey yo, what's up everybody? Welcome back to another reaction video. It's your boy Jesse Keegan, and today we're gonna do another reaction. Before we get into the reaction, guys, I want to say thank you to everybody who's been subscribing. You guys are super super amazing, and thank you for everyone who's been giving us suggestions on what to react on. And without any further ado, I'm gonna react to Ali Dawah Debunked Christianity in just 1 minute. Tough questions about Christianity. So without any further ado, guys, let's get it.
How would we know that Christianity is wrong?
Can you debunk the Trinity in 1 minute?
Are you saying disciples never met Jesus?
Please be honest and answer this question. Who dominates Speaker's Corner?
They say, who do I pray to? The Father? No, let me pray Jesus today. No, today, Holy Spirit. Who do I pray to? Anything that is in the creation cannot be God because they are dependent. Now Christians have gone to a length where they reject the Bible. They say, we don't need the Bible. And to me, it's like, wow.
Ali Dawah, you have 1 minute for each question.
You ready?
Are you ready?
Can you debunk the Trinity in 1 minute?
Well, it's very simple. They believe the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. These are all gods, but they are not the same as each other. So the point here is that if you think about it, they are all dependent on each other. Yeah? So if something is dependent on something else, it cannot be a creator. If Jesus walked the earth as a human being, ate, slept and went to the toilet, we do not believe this is deserving to be a God to be worshipped, you know? So that's the reason why the Holy Spirit, for example, is the same thing. It is in the creation. Anything that is in the creation cannot be God because they are dependent. And anything that's dependent cannot be deserving of worship.
They say that Muhammad copied Quran from the Bible, Hasha. What do you say about this?
We've got a lot of things to say about that. Not only that, the Christians have a lot to say too. Actually, the Christians talking helps our case because Allah says in the Quran that woe to those who change the scriptures with their own hands and say this is from Allah. This again is a prophecy. If you think about it, Allah saying the Bible is corrupted. They've changed it. Now, if the Bible was not corrupted, the Quran is wrong, right? If the Quran is saying the Bible is corrupted, it's been changed. If the Bible is not corrupted, that means the Quran is wrong. You have Christians today, Bart Ehrman, well, ex-Christian, Bruce Metzger, and many of them. And when you go to the Bible, you have footnotes. These are added in, which shows to us that the scriptures have been changed. It's a prophecy. But coming back to the question that you asked, this was a little bit off tangent. If that was the case, if the Quran copied from the Bible, why did it not copy the mistakes? For example, we know at the time of Joseph, there was kings. They were not pharaohs. The Bible calls them pharaohs. The Quran calls them kings. Why kings? Allah calls the ruler Pharaoh at the time of Moses, but when it talks about the time of Joseph, it says king. Why king? If it's king, that means that the Bible, it could have not copied from it. Because if it copied from the Bible, it should call the ruler what? Pharaoh. But it called it king. And this is historically correct because they deciphered the Rosetta Stone and they deciphered the hieroglyphics and they found out that at the time of Joseph, there was no pharaohs. So the Bible has been copied from someone else. And just because they copy, they shouldn't throw mud at us because we don't copy.
How would we know that Christianity is wrong?
The Trinity doesn't make sense logically. So we know when we look at the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, it doesn't add up. He's God, He's God, He's God. But the God, the Father is not the Son is not the Holy Spirit is not the Father, but they are all God. Logically, it doesn't make sense. Most Christians leave Christianity because of this. They say, who do I pray to? The Father? No, let me pray Jesus today. No, today, Holy Spirit. Who do I pray to? That's number one. Number two, the Bible. This is their scripture. So we ask a very simple question. Is the Bible the word of God? Yes. Can the word of God be corrupted? No. Okay. If that's the case, how do you have this many books added in? Yeah? 86, 72, 73, 66. This is books, books, big books thrown out. And what is this? You're playing toys. And then you look at the verses, for example, John 7, 5, 3 to Mark 8, 11, there's passages taken out. They realize it's not in the original manuscripts, yeah? So how can I trust? I always say this to the Christians. I say to them, if I was to give you a bottle of water or a glass of water, and I put one drop of poison, just one little drop, would you drink it? No. He says, no. I said, why not? He says, it will harm my body. How are you drinking the Bible when it's destroying your soul? You know it's corrupted. So how are you consuming the Bible for your soul, and you know it's been changed, it's been corrupted, this is not added in here, this is taken out there. We don't know who Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John is. Who are these people? They never met Jesus. In Islam, the oneness of God makes sense. Yeah? The Quran is preserved, hasn't been changed. And not only that, we have chains of transmission. We have books about the Sahaba, who they are, the Prophet ﷺ, how they met him, what they ate. We know everything about them. We don't know nothing about these disciples. We don't know nothing about the Bible. So from the top to the bottom, it's messy.
Are you saying disciples never met Jesus?
So to be honest, the question that needs to ask here is, who are these people? We know nothing about them. Like in Islam, we have chain of transmission, hadith, sanad. We have signs of hadith. We know mutawatir. We know how many people heard it. They have nothing. So if you read the new Jerome commentary of the Bible, which is the tafsir, like in a nutshell, like telling them who these individuals are, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. John, they're saying, which John are you talking about? Is it John the son of Zebedee, John the presbyter, or John the apostle? There's three Johns. They're saying, which one is the one? They don't know. So the thing is here, I'm getting information about the hereafter from people I don't know, from a book that they wrote inspired by God that's full of mistakes, and they are telling me about a God concept that makes no sense. This is janazah.
As far as I know, you go to Speaker's Corner every Sunday and present these arguments to Christians.
Yes.
What are their reactions?
Changes from Christian to Christian. Like Allah says in the Quran, laysu sawa. The Christians, the people of the book are not the same. There are good, there are bad. So the thing is, when you talk to them, they don't want to know. All they do is insult. Insult, swear, insult. But when you speak to a genuine Christian and you bring these arguments, they of course take it on board and say, okay, you know what? It cannot be from God. Now Christians have gone to a length where they reject the Bible. They say, we don't need the Bible. And to me, it's like, wow. Yeah, they're literally saying, we got Jesus. Well, how do you know about Jesus if there's no Bible? You know, you say no to the Bible, you say no to Jesus, because his resurrection, his death, his divinity is in the Bible. So now it's come to a point where they're saying, no problem, Bible is corrupted. Okay, yeah, we accept. We don't need it. We have Jesus. Like, well, what can you say to that? And the Jesus doesn't match one another, by the way, because I speak to someone, he says, I saw Jesus. I said, what does he look like? He says, oh, white hair, this stuff. I said, okay, 1 second. I call another guy. I said, you saw Jesus in your dream. He inspired you. What does he look like? Blonde hair. I said, he has white hair, he's blonde hair. It's two different people. How do you know it's not Satan? How do you know?
There are so many groups that comes to Speaker's Corner.
Yes.
Atheists, Muslims, Christians. Please be honest and answer this question. Who dominates Speaker's Corner?
Well, to be honest, with the amount of people that come, it's Muslims, like numbers. But with logical, Islam, Muslims, logically. Like I'm thinking, even if there was one Muslim, he would dominate that intellectually. And if there was 100 Christians, he will intellectually dominate all of them.
Our questions are complete.
That's why I want to ask you a question. You know, why do you not accept Islam after I've answered all of them? I mean, repeat after me. Ashhadu.
We are Muslim, alhamdulillah.
We are Muslim.
Hello, brothers and sisters, and thank you for watching the video. If you want to take a look at more of our videos like this, you can check the playlists we created specifically for you on the right, or you can check out our latest videos on the left. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to our channel so that we can reach and benefit more people. See you.
Well, okay, first of all, shout out to the people who created the video. I mean, it's really a good video to look at it. And the brother who's been asked, questions, also shout out to him to of having the courage to answer the questions, also to have that mind of supportiveness when it comes to his own religion and the way he's backing up his religion. It shows that there's a lot of passion in him and there's a lot of integrity and loyalty in his religion and whatnot, which is most of the people should have that kind of characteristics or behaviors or whatnot. But anyway, so the guy's been asked questions about Christianity and whatnot, and from the jump they asked about the Trinity and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, you know, first of all, when you look at the Bible and the Quran, these are holy books that are so like the same, but they are just little differences here and there. And they are Muslims and the Christians on the other end, and both of them tend to believe that there's God, and but they have different ways of, you know, kind of praying, and on the other end there's Muhammad, on the other end there's Jesus. There's some little differences, but it's just same book written, slightly differently. Yes, so now, first of all, I want to shout out to the Muslims. I mean, what I like about Muslims is that they have the unity of themselves, unity of just, they have the understanding of their Quran from front to back. They know it really, really well. The first thing that I kind of liked about the Muslims is that I was raised in a community where all my friends were Muslims. 10% of my friends were Christians where I used to school, so most of them were Muslims. And they will go for madrasa every single day. They'll go to madrasa and they were taught the Quran from front to back, how to recite, how to whatever, all these kind of things. And they would come out of that place really, really staunched, you know, with the idea that the Quran is the only book that was written by God, and this is the only book that will take us to heaven, which is a really good idea to be in that position, to understand that this is the only book that God created, that God wrote and brought it to us, and we have to understand it, and we have to be able to be able to position ourselves into this book and able to know what it's talking about and follow exactly what it says and whatnot. That's really incredible. That's really amazing. That's one thing I like about them. Another thing is the unity. The unity between themselves is just amazing. When I meet a Muslim, something else. It's like they know each other from just another mother. It's like a brother from another mother, you know, something like that. So I've been with my Muslim brothers. The kind of love and brotherhood that is in there is just super, super amazing. Now, I'm a Christian. I was raised a Christian, and I've been with my Christian brothers. I can tell you one thing is that it's like we don't tend to have the same kind of, you know, like kind of brotherhood the Muslim have, you know, because when you look at the, and I know why most of this thing come out like that, and I can just put out one or two things. Number one, most likely, is Christianity. There's a lot of denominations, and one out of eight people, you find them going to a different denomination. There's Pentecost, there's Anglican, there's Orthodox, there's Catholics. There's a lot of them, okay? So you meet your friends, but you have different sect of denominations. You guys are together on a Saturday, but on a Sunday, when you want to go worship the Lord, you're all separated into different kind of denominations, which is one thing that pulls back the people of Christianity when it comes to unity. Again, that's a way of dividing people, like divide and conquer and all those kind of stuff. They don't want you to be united. The more you're united, the more power you have. You get it? So I think the Muslim on this other side, they win because they're so united, and they're really in that brotherhood kind of level, which is super, super amazing. But there's one thing that I tend to disagree so much. I do understand that, yes, the Bible was kind of corrupted, and there's a lot of things that is mentioned in the Bible that it doesn't really correspond with how people react towards it and how people look at it in real life and whatnot. You get it? But again, should we be at a position to scrutinize the Bible and be at a position to say that this is not the right book, or I don't follow the Bible because it has been what, changed so many times and whatnot? What if I tell you today, what if the Bible is the real deal, and the only way to make the Christians not follow what the Bible says was to just change one or two books and whatnot and remove some of the things from there? Some people who are there before us probably saw that the Bible was so powerful to a point that if we give them the entire thing, they're going to know the truth. So probably they decided, okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to make sure that we give them this and we preserve this for ourselves, or for our own knowledge, so that they don't know exactly what Christianity it all entails. So we're just going to give them the part of the books, and we're going to try and edit some of them so that when they read it, they believe in it the way it is, but in the actual sense, that's not exactly what the original Bible talks about. You see, so if the Bible was really changed, which most likely, of course, we know that there's some things that were, I mean, it's kind of corrupt and whatnot. But again, if it's really corrupt, that means there might be something really important in that Bible that they didn't want us to know. There must be a knowledge that was changed or removed and whatnot, so that we are not in a position to get to understand the knowledge and whatnot. So again, let's not try and scrutinize the Bible, you know. Let's try and figure out what really was there in the beginning. Let's try to bring up the pieces and try to make it a whole again. But you see people like him who is trying to really Christianize Christians and whatnot, just because Bible has been changed so many times doesn't mean that it's not the right book or it's not the right religion to go with. No. Everybody has their own beliefs and their own faith. There's somebody who moved from Christianity to Islam and found peace. There's somebody who moved from Islam to Christianity and found peace. Everybody has a journey to go to, you understand? And there's always that turning point, you know? And a lot of people are having their own turning points. People are becoming more Christians and people are becoming more Muslims. Others are becoming, they don't follow the religion. They just have this knowledge of self and all this kind of thing that they believe in. And they end up just doing well. So for those reasons, let's not try to scrutinize the Bible and whatnot. Let's try to educate each other on how we can tackle important issues, how we can come together as a community, how we can help each other. Yes, I'm a Muslim, you're a Christian. How can we come together? Yes, I understand we have differences, but let's come together and help each other to strengthen ourselves so that we can be able to fight the enemy. The enemy is out there. Do you understand? The enemy is the people who are controlling us and who are trying to put us in a situation where we have to partake in some weird kind of practices and all those kind of stuff. So let's come together. The more we unite, the more we can be able to fight the 1%. Another thing he mentioned, he said a Muslim can be able to beat Christians. When it comes to the IQ, I don't know what kind of IQ he was talking about, but when it comes to the IQ, a Muslim will have an upper hand compared to a Christian when it comes to the Quran and the Bible. Anyway, let's not try to compare each other when it comes to such kind of situations. Again, I feel like it's so demeaning when you want to compare people like that. You know, IQ, or these people have a lower IQ. No. So I do understand that when you, not argue, when you are in a debate with a Christian, and when a Muslim and a Christian are in a debate, obviously we know who's going to lose. Okay, a Christian is going to lose because the Muslim brother knows that he knows the points where he can hit on the Christian brother, where he cannot even try to, you know, stand back and come back strong. You see, because when you look at the Quran is really astute. It's as good as perfect, you know, the way it is. And you can't find some scrappy things in there and whatnot, you see. But again, when you look at the Bible, that's where you can find things that are not appropriate and whatnot. But again, we shouldn't be at a position to say that, yeah, it was changed and all this kind of stuff. We understand all these things. Everybody knows, yes, the Bible was changed, the Quran is the perfect whatever thing. But should we start scrutinizing Christianity because another religion knows that it has an upper hand when it comes to their religion? No, we shouldn't do that. Okay? Let Christians be Christians. Let Muslims be Muslims. And the most important thing is that let's not fight each other. Let's try to come together as one. Let's help each other. There are bigger problems out there other than trying to understand why is Muslim. Not. This is one thing that it will never end. And I wanted to, I want to say something that is really important. We might not know anything. We might not even know what is really happening around. Only God knows. So we are only here to learn. We're just passing by. We're here to learn. As we go on, as we die, maybe that's where the great awakening comes through. But again, let's not try to scrutinize each other. Let's not try to feel like I have an upper hand compared to the other person. That's not good. Anyway, guys, just let me know in the comment section below. What do you think about the entire video? What do you think of my commentary and all this kind of stuff? If you have any kind of reactions you want me to do, just let me know in the comment section below. Another important thing, guys, don't forget to subscribe to our channel. If you want us to do more videos, just give us a comment. Let us know what you want us to react on. Another important thing also, please don't forget to hit that notification bell if you want to be the first person to watch our videos whenever we post them. Again, let's just be together. Let's get united. Let's help each other to reach the top. And without any further ado, I'm going to see you and deuces.